something about. I know what you're looking forward to most about open mics, Craig? You got an idea?
No. What do you do in open courses for this one?
Well, it paid because of open source.
Any other ideas? Besides PHP, what's your favorite language? And why?
Besides hack?
Besides PHP, hack. Oh, in tech, they recommend PHP. Sebastian, where did I talk about? Almost declared a dead.
Why, PHP? Well, I agree, but the interim between 5.3 and 7 was a long period, so hack.
Yeah, he said he helped him push 7 to get out. Kind of give him a kick in the butt to get started, but no, there was no reason to go. I thought much faster than 7. All right, so while we're eating pizza, we'll go ahead and start, we'll do introductions. So I'll just say who you are, where you work, and other languages. What, maybe your other favorite programming language, if there's something that says PHP you like, and why you like it. Or rather, what you're looking forward to open best, if you want to open best. And you're one, take your pet.
What about school and languages?
So let's go around, and then I'll end on me, and I'll jump to the presentation.
All right. Tom Anderson, I work for a company in San Diego called Note Vault. And I'm not going to go to Open West this year.
Favorite language besides PHP?
Oh, favorite language? I've been doing a lot of Angular, but Angular 1 is a lot easier than Angular 2, in my opinion. There's a lot more libraries out there to use. So I'm sticking with 1 right now.
So I'm Kyle Waters. I work at Venture Data. We do public opinion polling based in Hurry. Let's see, I said the Open West one, so I guess I should do Open West, huh? I am most excited to go and see this. Oh, wait, I've seen this one tonight.
Yeah, you don't have to have this one.
This one would be my. I go there and see some of the, let's say, design, something on design patterns and anti design patterns.
My name is Justin Gerge. First time here.
Program language you like then?
I like Python, but I don't get a chance to use it right now.
I'm Jason Peterson. I work for 1-800 Contacts. Looking forward to Open West to next my master's second day. But we'll see about that. And favorite language? Angular is good.
Do you do PHP at 1-800 Contacts, or is it C-sharp?
I do C-sharp.
Okay, I wrote my used to work there. Do you know what Tyson and I have a chance?
I don't know. Right.
Okay, he's been gone for about a year, so I'll do.
Derek Caswell, I work for Unique. I haven't actually gotten a chance to look at the lineup for Open West, so it's kind of hard to say what I'm looking forward to on it. I'm still deciding my phone. Other languages, I don't know. I mean, Java, I guess. I don't have a reason. It's the, I mean, I guess other than like JavaScript, and that's the only other language I've really ever programmed in.
Not gonna count Lasso.
Oh no.
Sorry, bad Skyvantage joke.
No, Lasso is awful. Lasso is terrible. I guess I could say that I have programmed in Lasso, but it's terrible.
Even more.
Yeah.
If you're picking Java over it, that's a pretty good warning.
I'm Rahul Ipar. I work for Android Software. And I like Java, actually. And for my master's, I did all the pretty in Java. Unfortunately, I didn't get much chance to work in Java. Now I'm working PHP on web technologies.
I'm Matt Hill. I also work at Unique. I've been playing with the Raspberry Pi for about 3 months for the first time, so OpenWest, anything Raspberry Pi, that's going to be my jam. Okay. And favorite language besides PHP right now, probably Node.
Mac Newbold, they work here at Vivint Smart Home. We're hiring .NET guys and probably looking for some Magento help if you know somebody. If I'm going to OpenWest, which I'm not sure about yet, we'll see how things go. We're pretty busy, but probably be looking around for some help. We've got so much going on. That would probably be the nicest thing to get out of OpenWest, would be more people to help us. And this is my son, Mark. He's hanging out with me tonight.
Brent James. Don't really work anywhere. I have some part-time stuff. Favorite other language would be Delphi.
I'm Jason Huddle. I work at Modernized Media at American Corp. I'm not going to OpenWest, but I'm going to LayerCon next month, so I'm pretty stoked about that.
Okay.
I've actually been getting into a lot of Vue lately, and Evan Yu is supposed to be doing the talk, so that's pretty, pretty cool.
So LayerCon?
Yeah.
What's that for?
The Laravel conference.
That's what I thought. I should go to that. I've been liking Laravel, right?
Yeah.
Remember where that one's at?
This year it's in New York.
New York.
Yeah. Unless you want to wait till August, then you can go to Amsterdam to LayerCon EU.
Yeah, I can even send you to Vegas, so.
my name is Jeremy. I just moved to Park City a week and a half ago, so I don't work anywhere.
Welcome to Utah.
Thank you. And I'm also going to LayerCon next month, my fourth one. So, my favorite language, I guess, is Laravel. Yeah.
All right.
Three other people said Angular, so.
All right, and of course, I'm Martin Ebergall. I work for a company based out of Denver. We do a few different SaaS products. I work on a drug testing platform. We do about 1 million drug test results a year. Dealing mostly with like truckers and pilots, big box stores. If you apply for jobs at Home Depot or Walmart or Walgreens, it will be a job that most of some of our users. OpenWest, I'm looking forward to it. I've got a few talks I'm given. I always like the some of the sidetrack stuff, like the lock picking and the soldering badges. I think that's always fun to do, so I look forward to that. You just want to go ahead and just introduce yourself.
So, I guess my cousin's in town. They want to do something with that, so I...
Okay.
But
I'm an accountant.
Yeah.
So.
That's fine.
We have pizza and brownies.
Yeah, grab some pizza and brownies. Go ahead. Grab some to eat here.
Microsoft paid for it, so it's
perfect for you.
What's your name?
Kip.
Yeah, so OpenWest. We'll go into like here a little bit about OpenWest a bit. About me, I've been coding in PHP for about a dozen years. Master's in Information Systems from the best college in the state. I don't read it right.
Yeah. Well, I can't remember where you went. You don't have it up there.
Utah State.
Oh, yeah, that's right. You were up there.
Yeah.
Sorry.
I was a regular at the Bin Cell up there.
That's right. Sorry. Yes, the best school here.
Senior software engineer. Which I'm very proud of. SSCP and SSLP, CSSLP certified, and subject matter expert. I go to workshops for and do exam developments. So if you ever take those certifications, I do the written tests, there are questions, reclassified questions, or review the questions and kick them out or modify them. Going in next month to Florida to do that. It's kind of fun to get into. If you ever want to even just study for cert, CSSLP is a fun one. It's a security minded software developer, QA, project manager, cert. But most of the tests is about hacking. So it's kind of fun. Even if you don't take the test, the topics are fun, at least to me. I enjoy flying drones. I have five little boys. We go fishing a lot. I go catch a bluegill off the docks over ponds up here, trout fishing, jumping some kayaks, whatever. Enjoy skiing, all their husbands. Questions about upcoming meetups? What are topics that you guys would be interested in hearing about? That's why I kind of put it out there to see what the interest is in any specific topics.
Architects or design patterns.
Design patterns?
Or architecture.
Any other topics?
Specifically, library creation.
I'd love to see those guys do stuff on Laravel.
Laravel?
Yeah.
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 Was there a Laravel group or is it just this one?
I don't think there's a separate one.
There is?
Any specific topics? Anything else? We try to do a soft topic every once in a while, but mostly technical talks. This is, of course, a soft topic this month, but try to shake it up a little bit. Any format change suggestions? I just put it out there. I talked to Victor a little bit. Victor Villa is organizing OpenMess. He gave a couple suggestions, things we could try out. He suggested we could do a hack night. We're actually doing that in September. They're doing a test fest for PHP Core. So September, we'll bring our laptops and write a test for PHP Core, and you could become a Core contributor at that point. Yep. Or if there's anybody wants to give a lightning talk, if you want to do that, let me know. If you want to have a talk, you want to 5 or 10 minutes at the beginning of the meetup, if you want to do that, feel free. If you have a talk at Open West, or if you want to submit to conferences, or just something you're really interested in, maybe it's Laravel, maybe it's design patterns, if you want to give a lightning talk on it, research it, give a talk, that's fine. So, would there be interest in doing like an intro to PHP at all? Apparently they used to do this in student group, but they stopped doing it a long time ago. But they'd have like a programming 101 basically for PHP developers. Be interested in that.
This is only my third or fourth meetup, and almost every single meetup there's been at least one or two people that's, I'm new to PHP, or I program in this other language but I'm interested, so something like that might be useful. It just depends on if any new people come.
Right.
Not necessarily just new to the group, but I mean, there's been people new to the language.
Right. Okay.
Yeah, that might be, like, if you give lots of prior notice, it might, like, that way we, the word can hopefully get out to people who maybe might not come all the time because I know when I first started coming here, I felt a little overwhelmed at times.
Right.
And
so. Imposter syndrome, maybe?
Yeah, a little bit, yeah, actually. And so, yeah, so, I wouldn't be surprised if there are people that have come that have just been like, I have no idea what they were talking about. I'm just trying to get started in this language.
Yeah.
So, if we can figure out a way to get the word to them that's what we're doing.
Might be good if we can get college groups somehow. There used to be all the Linux groups and all the colleges, but they don't play it off.
Yeah, I've actually gone to a lot of local university professors, but I haven't had much.
And if we had a meeting specifically geared towards that, we could somehow advertise it that way.
Okay. I was looking for a topic or speaker for November. That's what we could kind of shoot for. Of course, seasoned developers can obviously come too. Everyone can come and help maybe mentor. We can do a level up PHP thing. So
what do you need to know to be a programmer?
Yeah.
No, for me it's an easy answer. You need to know Git. And so if you want to do something off topic of PHP, Git might be a good way to go. The better you are, as a programmer. And as knowing Git, you can use that across everything you do. I mean, you can be a designer and use Git. And it have to be as effective for you as it would be for a programmer. So I could see that class.
Okay. That'd be good. That'd be a good topic, actually. Like, every developer at some point needs to learn it, or at least, especially as a contributing source.
Yeah, you better know how to use it if you want it.
Or you'll get rejected with your pull request. All right. Thanks for the feedback there. Some other things coming up. Open West is July 12th to the 14th. We talked about meeting possibly on Thursday. Recently was announced that they're going to have a community night that same night. So the question comes up for next month. For the meetup for UKHPU, we're going to have the meetup at Open West. If we do it Thursday night, the community night's that same night, they have, so they're going to have Nerf fights and movies and games and stuff. We could do it as just coming to the community night together. Meet up there, just do the games and stuff together, kind of a fun night. Or we could do it on a different night, like a Wednesday or Thursday, and have people give some
reason. What are those dates?
The 12th would be Wednesday, 13th would be Thursday, and 14th would be Friday.
Yeah, I don't know.
So is there any specific preference? Does who would be interested in doing just like games for UPGBU, or do you prefer like a Friday, have a summary of all the talks, and people be around on Friday? Friday?
No, I have no preference.
Okay.
But just general interest.
Right, okay. Any other thoughts or input?
I guess I would lean more towards doing like Friday or something like that. Just because,
okay,
like, you know, people who aren't doing Open West.
Right.
Not good.
Yeah, Victor said we can use the facility in the evenings. So we just meet up there. You know, it's like an hour after. Probably like a 6:30 kind of thing. Do Friday, we'll probably end up doing like a summary. Obviously, you can't go to all the talks, but you can report on maybe a couple of talks you went to, so just keep that in mind. We can plan to do something like that. If you went to a good talk, you want to share a little bit what you learned, just kind of open up for sharing things that you learned at Open West. And if you don't go to Open West, you can still come to us, so it's like you had to attend Open West to go to the evenings. So we'll plan on that one. We'll plan on Friday at 6 o'clock. After Open West. Is that way enough people to get there? All right. You mentioned August. You want to take August, Tom?
Yeah.
Okay.
Get those sound nice. I have a better showing object managers.
Okay. So we'll have you in August. September, doing test fest. I mentioned a couple times already. October, do a defensive coding crash course. It's a ZenCon preview. I'm going to give them, I think, next week. November, I mentioned we can do like a programming PHP classes, essentially go to my class and do it. December, often we don't have a meetup. I like this the 21st, it's pretty close to the holidays. We could do a Christmas party or just a holiday party or just skip it that month. Probably not skipping it unless it's a long-term party or something. So we'll talk about it. With that, we'll jump into the topic. This course is a soft topic. I'm going to go through just a few experiences I've had where I've absolutely felt imposter syndrome. And when I was in high school, 10th grade, I was in the gym, I was running, and the teacher said, you should go run cross country. So I went to the cross country practice the next day. I was like, hi guys. And they said, oh, let's go running. And we went and ran like 5 miles. It felt like I should have been there. I felt like I was completely out of place. That's kind of one of the first times I really remember feeling it. Like, these guys are, you know, these runners are fast, you know. I was, you know, kind of in the back of the pack, and everybody else was taking off, and I was like, wow, this is crazy, what am I doing here? That was one of the first times I really noticed feeling it. My first job, I worked at a smoothie shop, and not knowing what was going on. I was terribly slow. Maybe it was my engineering mind. I had to memorize all these, all the recipes before I could start making them fast. But the first month, really, I felt like I was out of place. Man, what am I doing here? I had no clue what's going on. Everybody else is making smoothies way faster than me. I stuck with it, and I would say, debatably the fastest person at the smoothie shop. I just took time, though. First IT job. Has anyone ever felt imposter syndrome at an IT job? Maybe especially the first one. I don't know. I worked at my first real IT job was up at Utah State in the financial aid and student employment office. And I know my resume was I had a bunch of computers at home. I had never done them. I was working as a doing computer engineering or information systems at that point. But I felt completely out of place there. You know, it took time to learn and I learned a lot from a mentor, my coworker. But it was a time when I had definitely felt imposter syndrome. I was just trying to learn the ropes and figure things out, and they worked. Probably the strongest time I've ever felt it was my first item ride for IC Square. I got my SSCP in 2008, and my first item writing was in 2011. These workshops are actually really fun, but the first one I went to, I felt completely out of place. But I get up there and do the introductions. You know, I'm a recent college grad, and I'm working as a software engineer. And most of the people there had 10, 20, 30 years of sysadmin or security architecture jobs. Guys that worked in the military for decades, and these were very seasoned. These were, you know, people that were writing articles and speaking at conferences across the country. A lot of the people there were, I felt, way beyond me. That was one of the strongest I've ever felt it. As the conference went on, I got to know the people. I started to realize I could write questions. I did write quite a few questions. I was able to hang with them. But they did obviously do more than I did. That was probably the strongest I've ever felt it. Speaker lounge at Ski PHP. Who went to Ski PHP 2 years ago? When it was up at Noah's place up there. I think it was the first time I'd spoken at a local conference besides Open West. And I remember walking past the speaker lounge a few times, looking in there, seeing if I should go in there, going, I shouldn't. You know, there's Adam Colton, Davey Shaffick, we mentioned earlier. We're sitting in there, you know, and a few others that were very well-known speakers. I'm like, I really should have. It takes some guts for me to get in there. I didn't feel like an imposter walking in there, to be honest. It wasn't until after I gave my first talk, I went in there decompressed, and I was actually talked to, you know, through the other speakers, and got to know them, and was like, they're pretty reasonable. You know, I talked to Eli White about talking, because he came to my talk, and I talked to him about the clock, and what he thought about it, got some feedback. So it ended up being really good to talk to him. Have you ever been in a tech discussion with someone, they're talking about something, he's like, yeah, I know that, yeah. And then, what do you do that night? You go home and start Googling that. The next day you show up at work, like, oh yeah, I remember that you were talking about yesterday? You know about it?
Your notes on your head.
All the time, right? I feel all the time, especially if you have some really smart coworkers. I feel like they start talking about some system administration or DevOps stuff, and I'm just like, I knew that. I was going to do that. the things that you start learning as time goes on, right? Justin hand off UPGU, I felt, what? I didn't feel like I felt like an imposter to me. I'm going to admit, not too long ago, I didn't know BIM. And every time someone pulled up the VI or BIM, I felt like a complete imposter. I'm like, what am I going to do? I know how to control Q and quit out here. So finally, I was like, you know what? I'm learning BIM, VI, whatever. At the time, I learned it. I'm comfortable in it. That's another example. I was changing my things to use Nano instead, or use a text editor. I'm trying to avoid it. I don't know why I avoided it for so long. That was one example, or maybe there's a technology you use where you try to avoid it because you're not familiar with it, maybe. That's one for me. Whether it's just it took time, deciding I'm going to learn it, took the time I learned it, it was easy, comfortable using some of those. Lunch with the conference crowd a few weeks ago, I went to PHP Tech, and after the conference was over, people were heading off to the airport. There's a group that's going off to the hotel, or off to a nearby restaurant to go have lunch. And of course, there's a lot of speakers. I think you have a tutorial, but I was like, I felt out of place a little bit, I ended up, someone spoke up and said, hey, come with us, come on, just come with us. Okay, I went with them. And it'd be really fun. I had a good chat about the conference and about places they'd been and stuff. So that was the time I felt it recently. So I've given kind of a few examples. I want you to be thinking about maybe times you felt it. We'll get to you here in spot in a little bit, but we'll have you open up for everyone else here to share their experiences. But could you relate to some of those experiences I gave? Does some of them feel familiar? So let's start thinking about some of the experiences you've had, or you've felt it as we go through this. Hopefully, as we go through this, it'll help you realize that, you know, perhaps some of those times where you had achieved something, and you can look at those experiences differently in the future. So we'll go through what imposter syndrome is exactly, who experiences it, how to handle, how do we cope with those different experiences, and recognizing accomplishments that we've gained as you've gone through life and development materials. So imposter syndrome, okay, there's two different spellings. They're both technically correct. Impostor versus imposter, O, E, but I'll use the O version, but according to dictionaries, both of them are perfectly acceptable. According to Merriam-Webster, it's a person who pretends to be someone else in order to deceive others, especially for fraudulent gains. The definition of imposter. So imposter syndrome is that feeling that you really shouldn't be there, like you're a fraud, right? The experience, your response to the experience, is also called imposter phenomenon. Technical papers, or technical papers, but research articles will often refer to it as IP.
Is it limited to the beginning of experience?
We'll get to that in just a second.
Okay.
Yeah. Imposter experience is also called fraud syndrome. There's another reference to it. It is not, technically, it's not counted as a mental illness. OSMI, the open sourcing mental illness, if you know Ed Finkler or Joe Ferguson, they both work with that organization helping with mental illness. But imposter syndrome is not counted underneath the mental illness umbrella. It's not a personality trait. It's a reaction to an experience. It's something that you feel as a result of something that happens around you or a situation that you're in. It's a fear of being exposed, maybe as a fraud or as an imposter. Often you hear someone say, I just got lucky, right? Well, I just got lucky to pass the test. You know, I just got lucky to accomplish this great thing. I just got lucky to get this business off the ground. I just got lucky as a software engineer. They'll say they had good timing, right? People are rationalizing why they accomplished these things. You know, so I just got perfect timing, I just got lucky. Maybe they thought that they deceived someone else. Maybe a job interview, they got a job, new job, and you feel like, I deceived these people. That's the only reason why I really got this job, right? I didn't really do it. Fraud, hiding amongst others, maybe you feel like a fraudster. Kind of hiding in the group, maybe you're not speaking up because if you say something, someone's going to find out that you really don't know what you're talking about. It's kind of that feeling. The feeling of incompetence, maybe self-doubt, smart enough, that's a common one you hear. Someone thinks that you're not smart enough, a fake, a phony, a fraud. It's a feeling that you don't belong with your peers, right? These are people that you work with, perhaps, maybe some people that you to use a group with, right? We're all peers here, right? It's a feeling that you need to be better to be accepted, that you're not good enough to be within that group, or you're not qualified, right? Like when I went to that item writing for IC Square the first time, I didn't feel qualified. I felt like I shouldn't have been there. Really, it was an accomplishment to be invited to something like that. I mentioned it was kind of the smile and nod, oh yeah, I know what you're talking about, and I go look it up afterwards. Talk about the next day, what's going on. You really didn't know what was going on at first.
Now, on that note, is that because you feel like a fraud, you feel like an imposter, you feel like you have to fake it?
Yeah.
It's not okay to say, I don't know.
Yeah.
Because you're uncomfortable feeling like they're already looking down on you.
Yeah, it's just feeling like, you're going to, it's a feeling that you should know or that you do know about it. You should not qualify. You're with your coworkers, right? So instead of asking, you don't want them to know that you're not smart, right? So you're not going to say anything.
So if you didn't have imposter syndrome, you'd be okay saying, yeah, I really don't know what I have any idea what you're talking about.
Yeah, if you wanted to admit this, I don't know what you're talking about. What is it?
You'd have that confidence. Okay.
Any other questions? We'll go into the kind of the history behind it too here in a second. That's my hope. In the research by it, It turns out it's an inability or unwillingness to internalize accomplishments or to accept recognition for things. And not accepting internally that accomplishments are actual reality, that you actually did do something great, or that you accomplished something, or learned about something. Pauline Clance and Suzanne Ives in 1978 did a study of high-achieving women. They found that many of them felt over-evaluated and believed that they were not intelligent. And these are high-achieving women, and they're feeling like they're imposters, yeah, imposter syndrome. Even though they'd actually, you know, they were high achieving, they were high qualified, they were smart, but here they are feeling like they were intelligent. Pauline Clance could say, if I could do it all over again, I would call it imposter syndrome or experience, because it isn't it's not a syndrome or a complex or milk toast illness. It's something almost everyone experiences. Right? So it's a reaction to experience. So who experiences it? About 70% of people. It's most common in women, minority groups, high achievers. It happens in all industries. These are kind of some funny ones coming up, but people that you probably know that have experienced it. You recognize that guy?
Forrest Gump?
Tom Hanks, the famous actor, right? Forrest Gump, he's running. He says, look, the title is Lucky Guy. It's about somebody who is almost good enough to deserve what he achieves, and I understand that I still feel sometimes that I'd like to be as good as so-and-so. I see some other actors' work, and I think I'll never get there. I wish I could. He was feeling imposter syndrome. Very well-known actor, right? Someone very famous, very well-known. Sheryl Sandberg, Facebook CEO. She says, there's still days when I wake up feeling like a fraud, not sure I should be where I am. Right? She's the CEO of Facebook. That's an accomplishment, right? You don't just get there by being dumb, right? You have to know what you're doing. That's a successful company, large company. She filled it. Denzel Washington, member of the Titans. He says, the last 5 minutes before you go on that first Broadway preview, you don't have that, what am I doing here, Philly? You don't have that, and they say it's time to quit. He's saying actors feel like that. They feel like they shouldn't be there. Supreme Court Justice Sonia Sotomayor. She says, I'm not a classic imposter syndrome person because I have that initial insecurity, but I'm capable of stepping outside and proving to myself that's wrong. So she has the ability to recognize her, right? She's recognizing these experiences. So she has that initial reaction as an imposter, but she's able to realize that she is successful. Or has, I thought it was a really good quote there. It's a really good approach to the imposter syndrome. Neil Armstrong, he felt out of place. He's at a gathering for people who accomplished great things. He was talking to somebody. And the guy he was talking to felt like he shouldn't be there. And then he says, Armstrong tells him, I feel like I shouldn't be here. I didn't do anything. I just walked on the moon, right? That's all. And he felt out of place. He felt imposter syndrome. Anybody want to sing the song for us? 21 Pilots, Stressed Out, kind of going some Mars, band. The whole beginning, if you listen to it, you think about it. I wish I found out, I wish I did this, wish I did that. The whole part to me at least sounds like an imposter syndrome, right? They're wishing they could see better. They wish they could do things better. Really, they're a very successful band, right? Anyone recognize these two people? The reason why I want to talk about it, this setting, is that it's rampant in the IT world, right? Many developers experience it. Especially software engineers. Bill Gates, Mark Zuckerberg, many other greats have experienced it. There's a few that maybe won't admit it, but who here has felt it? Let's put this to a vote. Who here has felt imposter? I see most hands going up, right? Okay. Very common feeling. especially in the IT world where things are constantly changing, right? Every month there's something new that, you know, as a developer you've got to learn, right? What's the most recent thing? I don't know. Maybe it's at least a recent security breach, or maybe it's a change to PHP, or maybe it's a tool that, you know, you should be using. Maybe one day they're saying you should be using Mercurial, that was Git, SDN. Hopefully they don't use the same thing. You know, there's all these different tools that we're using, different frameworks, microservices. Maybe it's, you know, people are telling you should be using Docker, you know, Lindis, or Ansible, or SaltStack, or whatever. Now, there's all these different things that can come up. And as a developer, it takes energy and time to keep up. And so imposter syndrome is very common in the IT world. I knew that this was coming up. So I mentioned that tech. And I was listening to the speakers because I wanted to see if speakers would say some of the keywords. And I noticed, especially among speakers who were women, who were IT, and they're speaking at conferences, right? There was a few of them that were saying the word just a lot, or they felt lucky that they were there. And some of them too. There were some speakers that didn't, but there's about a third of the speakers gave hints or cues that they had imposter syndrome. I was kind of surprised. Now, having researched and preparing for the talk, I went with the mentality of, you know, watching for it, which most people probably don't. But I went with that perspective, and I noticed it. They were feeling insecure. They were apologizing. There was a keynote where the keynote speaker was apologizing for knowing stuff. I was like, what are they doing? This is a very smart person. She knows what she's talking about. She's well-respected. And she's apologizing in her keynote. I was like, what? Do we get these same feelings? You know, how are we, you know, as we go through these things?
Doesn't apologizing, especially when you're talking about something you know, make you feel like you know, like you're bragging? And I think that's where some of that apology comes from.
Yeah, I can see. Yeah, it depends on how it's gone about, you know. Yeah. Joe Ferguson recently posted, he's talking about how he reviews talks. And he says, I've been really lucky to have opportunities. I've been lucky enough to have some really awesome people mentor me. I'm lucky enough that a conference organizer buy my book. So he's using the keyword lucky, right? I kind of had a chuckle when I was reading this, like, Joe, you know what you're talking about, right? He's a core contributor to Laravel, right? Is he in this Laravel? Yes, or whatever.
So I know his name. Yeah. I think is the name of the guy that runs Homestead now.
Yep. He gave a talk last year called, oh my gosh, why am I blanking on this? Something about just assuming and going with it. Silence is acquiescence. And he makes a big deal about how you are the product of your choices. You are where you are because of your choices. You determine your fate. So it's really interesting to then contrast that with these quotes right here that I've been really lucky.
Yeah. I know. I think he is trying to give credit to people that have accepted him to speak. But you know, he gives really good talks. I've gone to some of his talks. He's a really smart person. Right? Here he is saying he's lucky that he knows these people. And it's kind of funny when I'm reading this, but, you know, because he's a humble brag, right? Or, you know, he doesn't want to admit, but he is, you know, he's really smart. He knows what he's talking about. So, anyways, I kind of have a chuckle when I read that blog. It was just like last week they posted that, too. It was just about talking about how he reviews topics or something. I posted up a Twitter poll. Is have you experienced imposter syndrome? I got 100%. It's only 9 votes, but everybody that read it said yes. There were no votes. That was during PHP Tech. I posted it out there and threw hashtags to try to get more people here. 100% of the people that voted took it. So who's experienced it and would be willing to share what they have felt?
Well, I shared back in April that when I got my first big, when I got my first full-time job, and it was like, here, write this program. And in my case, no one was supervising me, and it's like, am I qualified to be doing this? Am I? Of course, I haven't been writing it all in the house, so maybe it wasn't. Maybe it was right. But yeah, it was just like, wow, you're trusting this all to me. But you know, I'd gone to school. I had proven myself with other smaller projects first off, and then the UV project, because they liked what I was doing. And it has saved them a lot of money, so you know, it's worked out.
So it worked out.
Yeah.
But you definitely felt it.
Yeah, definitely felt like I shouldn't be the one doing this. Right. I'm not qualified to be making these decisions for this company. Yeah.
No one else. You guys felt it.
I think it's interesting you mentioned about how technology changes so rapidly and how that makes us especially vulnerable to imposter syndrome as an industry. I get this every 6 months when I have to pick up something new. And one that stands out was when I was at Inside Sales about a year ago, and we decided we needed to break up our monolith, adopt Node, keep some PHP as REST APIs, and then put everything in Docker containers. So for 2 to 3 months, I was learning Docker and starting the migration process and figuring out how we were going to assemble all of that, putting together an entire infrastructure. It was comparable to things I'd done in AWS or in Apache before, but it was very new. There is the learning curve, and I was like, what am I doing here? I can't figure this out. I'm too stupid. I'm not getting over the learning curve as fast as I'd like to.
Right. Good example, right? And that learning curve, you feel like you should know it, but you maybe you don't know it as well as you hope. And you hope. So you're hurrying trying to learn it because you don't know the people to find out that you don't know about it, right? So you're putting some extra time maybe and trying to learn it faster. Very good example.
I had a couple of instances that are coming to mind. I fully agree with what he just said, that it happens all the time. What's interesting is that, you know, these new technologies will come out, and it seems like there's instantly somebody who's an expert at it, like as soon as it comes out, like, and you end up talking to that person, you're like, oh, okay, I'm dumb, I gotta go figure this out now too, you know, like, that's what it seems like to me anyway. But the two instances for me was my first IT job was working for the Marriott School of Business at BYU, and they wanted me to write a PHP script that uploaded videos so they could use for the marketing department, so they could upload videos to this server and be able to stream those videos from any classroom. And I was just like, well, I know how to upload files. I don't know jack about streaming videos though, or any of that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
So, you know, I was just like, okay, what have I gotten myself into here? So that was one case. The other one was actually when I first started coming here. I was just, like I said earlier, I kind of felt like my head was swimming because I was still really, you know, kind of in my infancy of programming, and I was, every month I was going home. And just like you say, is pulling up Google and being like, okay, what were those guys talking about? You know, because I was more or less just kind of sitting back and listening because I didn't really have a whole lot to give input on.
I felt the same way when I started going to user group out in Denver. It's a very good point. I felt like I'd go to these user groups out there and be like, I don't know what they're talking about. I go home and read about it, learn about it over time. Yeah, over time you become more comfortable, but that, especially that first time you go to a meetup, it's hard. Who was here for the first time? Was it easy to come? No. How many times have you thought about coming but not?
Yeah.
I thought about when I first went to either went down from Denver. I probably thought about 8 or 9 times before I actually went out. Good example there. Anyone else want to share the time they experienced it?
I had one in the military. Because I went into the military as a mechanic, decided that was boring and ended up being a driver for the commander and kind of got put in an interesting position. You know, I've been the family IT guy, you know, ever since I was, you know, 12 years old.
Right.
I found programs that, you know, back on my mom's DOS machine that wouldn't even run Windows 3.0 that, you know, we would consider them jokes now, but she didn't think it was funny, you know. So I've been the family IT guy. They found out I was good with computers and they ended up pulling me into the IT department for my battalion. It was like, okay, doing some little stuff. We were deployed when it happened, got back to the States, and you know, pretty much the whole staff that I worked with that was above me in the IT department, they all PCS'd to a new unit. I didn't, so it was, oh, okay, now you're in charge. You know, and 6 months later we deployed again. You know, yeah, I've networked some stuff, but we get back to Iraq and all of a sudden I'm responsible for, you know, 500 computers and 2,000 user accounts on a network spread across Baghdad. That's pretty crazy, you know, when you think about it. And, you know, I ended up writing a whole web ticket system so people out on the other FOBs could request help and get help before they showed up so we could be prepared, or, you know, we could remote in and fix issues across the board. And, you know, it actually turned out really well, and I actually ended up getting our comms and, you know, different like awards in the military because of how I ran that. But there's definitely, you know, 500 computers and 2,000 user accounts is a lot different than, you know, your aunts and uncles' machines.
Right.
So there's definitely some of that going on, but, you know, it's still kind of like, you look back at it, you do what you got to do in the moment, but you look back and it's like, wow, was I really doing all of that? You know, and so it is kind of hard to internalize that. And especially if it's at the right scale, you know. A lot of people here, you go to a company, like the job I had before the one I'm at now, I was the IT manager there. We had maybe 70 or 80 computers, maybe 120 user accounts. You know, it's hard to put that type of scale into perspective when you're trying to interview, because those numbers don't sound real. So, you know, even after the fact, even if you've accepted it and like, yeah, okay, I did that, I accepted the award, you know, I am proud of that, but trying to convince other people sometimes is hard too. You know, you see that on, you're interviewing for a job, somebody sees, well, tell me about this, and you just like start talking about it again, it almost brings it back. Like, wait, can I really do that? So it's an interesting concept, the whole imposter. I would definitely call it an experience, you know, because you wane in and out of it.
Right.
So.
Oh, excellent, that's a good, very good example. Feeling it, and you said you recognized that it was an achievement, right? You recognize afterwards that you did something really good, you did a job as well.
Yeah.
That's an important part of imposter syndrome, is a good moment, is being able to recognize that you achieved something.
Yeah.
So when I go join new groups, like I'll give an example of joining an online forum, I try to avoid imposter syndrome by saying who I am right from the beginning. So like this, I joined this power and generator news group, and I got on there, people are talking about generators, diesel generators the size of a semi truck. And they're working with like this kind of stuff, and they're putting two phase and three phase AC power throughout, you know, hundreds of yards. So I just put up what I did and gave a good description of what I do, and I felt, and nobody like came back and said anything to me about it, but beyond like maybe a question or two. But by telling people that at the beginning, it makes me not feel that imposter syndrome. Like the first time I went to San Francisco or San Diego PHP, I walked in there and everyone's got a beer in their hand, San Diego. And so I just said, hey, I'm Tom Anderson, and I started going off on the projects that I've been involved in. And they're like, oh yeah, yeah, some people recognize me, so.
Oh, cool. Yeah, that's a very good, we'll get into that here, just a bit coping with and handling it. But yeah, introducing yourself, explaining kind of where you're at up front, really helps prevent having to do a imposter syndrome. That's a very good approach. Anyone else want to share it before we move on? Thanks for everyone's experience. Those are really good to share how you felt in the past. So I had any experiences. I connect to the Wi-Fi. We'll just skip it. But basically, this video is a guy shows up as a developer. You know, he kind of fills out a place. He gets stuck on something. And coworker comes up to him, is like, "Oh man, see, you just do that." And then the guy feels all dumb. You know. And then later on, he learns to develop, and then he sees a new guy have the same problem he had. Instead of being kind of jerked about it, he goes up and talks to him, explains, you know, this is the fix, you know, I've done that a million times. You know, see, so that was the video, basically. But It's important to not be toxic, be someone that's intelligent, feeling it. It's important to be more of a mentor, take that approach. And some people, you've experienced it too. Because many people have felt it, many people do feel it on a regular basis. Ask questions, be willing to ask for help. And Tom, you mentioned that you kind of explain your backgrounds, and then you kind of explain what you did. That was a really good example.
Whatever it is, it's contextual to the situation.
Right. Yeah. Explaining what you've done related to it is very good. I found that too in the last couple months. I try to kind of do these things more often. Found it makes the conversations a little easier. Maybe I'm talking to the DBA about a database issue, and you mention something that I don't know who he's talking about. And I'll ask about it, rather than just saying, oh yeah, yeah, I'll ask about it, and he'll explain it better. And I'll have a better idea what's going on, and the issues can move along faster. That's something I found recently. Some of the research says that you can write your feelings or writing therapy. I haven't actually tried this, but it explained you can list out accomplishments. So maybe if you're writing, maybe it's like keep a journal, right? Like to blog or whatever. That's one approach you can use. Associating those accomplishments, writing it down helps you internalize that, helps you reflect on that. Whether that's a blog or a tweet, whatever you want to do, however you want to communicate that. Developing a support group. User group is maybe a support group. It might be maybe your own Slack channel or some coworkers, some friends, whoever. To be able to discuss those experiences with, some positive feedback, saying, oh, you're doing great, Give some encouragement. Attending community events. Open West, of course, is coming up. That's a great opportunity if you attend a conference. It's a fun one. I found that Open West has all sorts of different ranges of experience. You can go talks that are people right out of college, and they're explaining something they've worked on. And those are really fun to go to and hear how they learned about it, and consider what you're doing. Maybe you go to someone that has many years of experience. You can learn from their years of experience. So there's different levels, and it's a good conference to kind of get ideas from. I mentioned it's hard to be a mentor to others. If you've gone through an experience and you're talking to someone, you kind of cue in that they might be feeling that same way. Be positive. Talk to them. Avoid being toxic. Talking down to them, or being rude. Consider how they might be feeling. Give them a sincere acknowledgement. Encouraging someone to keep going, to keep learning, to keep pushing forward. I mentioned in tech, I went to Sammy Powers. He talked about contributing to PHP for the testing. And that was a really good one. And here was someone that is very knowledgeable in the area. And he was encouraging the attendees and going through exactly how, step by step, how to do this. And giving encouragement. So that was a good example of a speaker who did that. So recognizing your accomplishments, acknowledging successes, accomplishments, and giving a pat on the back. This is one I have a hard time with. I have a hard time when people give me a compliment. I don't know what to say most of the time. I have a hard time knowing how to respond to those. So being able to accept recognition, accept compliments can be difficult for some. Me, it's difficult. Just being able to say thank you, maybe explain how you learned about it. There's no need to apologize. If you did something great, you don't need to apologize for it, right? That's a common imposter syndrome symptom, we call it. Apologizing for learning something or knowing about something. And don't diminish it. Say, oh, I just barely know about it, right? Even though you really do know more about it than you think. So avoid diminishing your recognition. Avoid talking it down like it's nothing. Not being prideful, not too much. And also working on some of the self-confidence, and being proud of what you've achieved, right? It takes time, it takes effort to achieve those kind of things. Remember that you do belong in that group. The groups are built to encourage and teach each other, right? It's not a ranking system where the better the more you know, the better you are, or whatever. Everyone's trying to learn together, right? As a team, as working as a development project, perhaps, you work as a team.
Something on your last slide, I was thinking, you know, where you were talking about people downplaying what they know. They'll say, oh, I don't know it very much. There's Dunning-Kruger effect. There's an actual effect where they've researched it. The more you know about something, the more likely you are to underrate your abilities. And the less you know about something, the more you are to overrate your ability. And so, yeah, a related thing that's been documented as well.
I have absolutely seen that. We do phone screens for job interviews. And a lot of the newer developers will rate themselves very highly. Or, you know, we'll tell them, rate yourself on a scale of 0 to 10. 0 means you've just heard of it. That's about it. Or never heard of it. 1 is you've heard of it. 5 is you've had, you know, maybe some pretty good experience. You're pretty comfortable with it. You say 10 is you basically invented it, right?
No, not basically.
Yeah. Because like we do on the scale, we've had people that are fairly new to the technology say that they're like 8, 9, or even 10. Wow. Bring them in and talk about questions, ask them questions. And they don't, maybe they don't know about us. Yeah, I just got to see that. Then you have also people that know a ton about it and they underrate themselves. You know, start asking questions and they know everything you can think about, right? So, yeah, thank you. Yeah, that's a good point.
Dunning-Kruger.
Dunning is what it's called.
I think part of that just comes from being naive about the topic.
Yeah,
that is.
You know, it's, oh yeah, I know about it. Well, you've only ever touched 5% of it. So maybe you know that 5% really well.
Right.
But you're not aware of it. I mean, I've been writing PHP since PHP 3, and there's still stuff that's like, well, what the hell is that? You got to pull up the docs and, you know, see what the method does, because somebody else used it in a piece of code. And it's like, oh, I didn't realize there was something built in to do that. I've done it this other way this whole time.
Yeah, the more I learn PHP, the more I learn I don't know.
Yeah. Well, and that's, I think it's true of most anything, which is why this
yes.
is the case,
yes.
because the more you know, the more you realize you don't know.
Yeah. That's a good point. I like that. Any other comments or questions? So community support. We mentioned user groups, you have communities online, communities as conferences that you can turn to for help and asking questions, learning more, pushing your boundaries. You're trying to accomplish those great things you want to achieve. You know, if you have specific goals you want to reach, you know, if you want to learn more about different things, you can go to different user groups. Or maybe if you're going to Open West, attend a conference or talk that you're not familiar with, try to push yourself in that. Get to know the community members there. Push your career ahead. Do you have a 5-year plan? Where do you want to be in 5 years? Anyone have a 5-year plan? 10-year plan? Retirement plan?
Not at work, only in personal
life. Personal life, yeah. Any more in personal life? You know, we spend a lot of time at work, but we don't consider our long-term goals very much. You know, there's specific promotions you want to work for, job titles, roles, different things. What do you want to accomplish? Set up those goals, think about it, spend 5 minutes, spend 8 hours a day or more at work, right? Push your career ahead and recognize your accomplishments as you move along. Maybe you're a junior developer and you want to become a senior developer. What do you got to learn to get there? Maybe you're a senior engineer, software engineer, and you want to become an architect. Or maybe you want to be a director of engineering or CIO or whatever. Now think about where you're at and where you want to get to. Consider your accomplishments you've made so far. Internalize the accomplishments you've made and see where you want to get to. Maybe you understand architecture better than you think, right? Maybe you understand PHP or JavaScript or whatever you're learning better than you think. I wanted to put this one in here. This is kind of related. Salary servers is something we really don't talk about much. But how much are you earning, right? We're not going to ask you how much exactly you're earning. Salary surveys say that software engineers nationally earn about $95,000. That's a pretty good salary, right? Salary.com for Lehigh or Utah County says entry level is $55,000, mid level is $70,000, senior is $88,000, and staff engineer would be $124,000. That's for software engineer. Again, I don't want to know how much. I'm not asking how much you're. I'm not going to ask that. But think about it. You know, what are you currently what does your salary look like? Are you significantly underpaid? You know, maybe are you? Is there something you have achieved that maybe you might be recognized for, or that you are unwilling to, you know, say something, speak up for yourself? It can be hard.
What is a staff?
Staff is one step above. It's like the architect. Usually you have the architect and you have staff above that. So senior. My coworker Dave Stock, if everyone knows, he has this big list of, that defines out what everything is. So, you know, you basically go from developers, you have junior, mid, senior developer, then you have software engineer, junior, mid, senior, and then you have architect, and then you have staff. Where staff is, you know, going to be, you know, a manager of developers.
Oh,
like
okay.
Senior staff,
part like of a man, like a man, more of a managerial position.
Yeah, usually
okay.
Lots of mentoring usually, but mm-hmm. Usually not doing a lot of new stuff yourself.
Right.
Might be similar to what some places call a principal developer
principal.
Or something like
yeah.
That.
In our company, they have like director of engineers.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Great guidance.
My general observations. Again, this is split between Denver and Salt Lake, because I've lived in Denver for about 5 years. We're moving back out here. 0 to 3 years is usually about 45 to 70,000 for a software engineer, PHP. 4 to 6 years is about 70 to 90. 7 to 9 years, 90 to 120, and 10 plus years is usually about 100 plus. Something to just consider. Again, that the last one's my observations or my what I've seen through a lot of hiring we do, and also looking at other job postings. I'm not looking, but I'll occasionally glance and just kind of look at the current trend is in the market, looking at different salary surveys and stuff. This is something to consider. You know, have you achieved something? You know, are you at a certain level where maybe you can internalize your accomplishments and make a jump or progress? You know, what is the value of your accomplishments? Right? Do you know more than you think? Are you willing to? Can you go to those interviews? Ace them. Maybe you can. Maybe you don't think you can, but maybe you can. So I just want to put that out there. It's something we don't talk about a lot. We don't talk about imposter syndrome either, so it's kind of goes in the mix, right? but just think about it, you know? If you observe that you're below where you think, consider it. You know, maybe just talking to HR or maybe talking to your director or whoever manages you about your salary, where the national average is. You know, you can bring some numbers and say, you know, after the national average for this nation's this, and for this area, it's the specific range. You know, for these number of years of experience, salary.com does also have like the number of years that you typically see and the ages and stuff too. But they have college degrees and other things, kind of some other demographics. But you know, that's something to consider. You know, it kind of goes along with imposter syndrome. You know, are you accepting your lower salary because you undervalue yourself. Right. Any questions about this stuff? Besides asking how much people are. By the way, usually employer will tell you not to tell you how much you earn, but legally they can't. So again, we kind of go over my experiences. Kind of wanted to help give an idea of what it was. We went over to imposter syndrome, some definitions, definitions of what it was, research history about it, who experiences it. You know, often we see it again in women, minority groups, older developers, is another category. And as a whole, the IT world, software engineers, DevOps, sysadmins, DBAs, often those groups often fill it. You know, there's a higher percentage amongst the IT world. There is other industries. Other industries do fill it, but the IT world in particular is hard. Talk about how to handle it, some things you can do. Really it's that focus on being able to internalize those accomplishments, recognizing what you've done. Maybe it's the financial value of your accomplishments, maybe it's recognizing achievements, accepting rewards perhaps. There can be all sorts of different things. How you internalize it, how you accept that. Maybe it's just a karma you get from a project, right? You accept the karma from helping out the project. PHP Charles does karma, by the way. It's kind of funny. Levi, we talk about it. It's kind of funny to learn about that one. So. And reflect on your past experiences. When have you felt it? Keep pushing yourself forward towards any goals that you want to achieve. Maybe whether it's promotions, roles you have, you want to become a team lead, or you want to learn about QA automation, whatever it's going to be. Are there any questions? Any thoughts? Anything you want to know?
What found your interest in this?
This is from, because I've felt it, I've experienced it a lot. I have felt it too many times. and haven't really talked about it, so I submitted as a abstract to OpenWest, accepted. So. And the other talks I'd already given.
Okay.
I wanted to give it as a group. And I find this environment is especially good for feedback. You guys gave a lot of good experiences that you've had. So that was really helpful for me. We talked about Kruger,
Dunning-Kruger.
That was kind of cool.
Yeah. I thought the salary part was interesting. I think when people think about imposter syndrome, they don't think about that as much. And it actually is one of the things I was thinking about as you were talking, that I think one of the real problems with imposter syndrome is that we end up not, we don't sell ourselves. And if you really want to get promotions and raises and that kind of thing, you got to know how to sell yourself, and that's that was something I kind of learned with my experience with my last job, is that I just, I had to, it was only once I started realizing that, hey, yeah, I really do know what I'm talking about here. I am worth a lot more than I make right now, which is why I changed jobs, and that kind of thing. And until you realize that, you're gonna hold yourself back a lot.
Yeah, absolutely. I've seen that too. The salaries I've had in the past, I've got at one point I've doubled my salary just switching jobs. It's just, it's talking about being kind of undervalued at that point. So that's a really good example.
I just want to say I agree with him. That's a really good part of the talk, is having that there.
It's one of the later things I added, so I'm glad I added it.
Yeah.
But I was thinking about it, it's get tied to financial value to your accomplishments.
How's this hurting you? Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, and as a matter of feedback for the talk, like for OpenWest, I would go into that. I would say, this is where imposter syndrome can really hurt you. Is that if you see yourself, if you're looking at these numbers and you're saying, well, I've been working for 6 years, but I'm only making $40,000 a year, then evaluate that. Realize that maybe you're not, maybe you're holding yourself back.
That's a good point. I think I'll expand it out. I'll go into a little bit more. So that's good feedback. Any other feedback? Because I think I'm going to get this to OpenWest. If you have other feedback you want to give me to do better on this stuff.
Yeah, define it at the beginning of the.
Define imposter syndrome
at the very beginning.
Yeah, I was trying to.
It kind of
worked on that one.
It kind of eats us into it,
Yeah.
We had to make some guesses as to why. I had to make some guesses.
Okay.
As you went through those first four or so slides.
So maybe a quick definition at the beginning before I go
into it. Yeah, putting up the dictionary definition is good for me.
Okay. That's a good point.
I've heard of imposter syndrome before. I'd never heard of imposter experience. And I found it really interesting that the quote you had about the woman who, did she define it? Like, did she coin the phrase? And then she comes back later and says, I wish I'd used the phrase imposter experience. That might be a little bit of a grab because people wouldn't be necessarily familiar with that. What's imposter experience?
Right. Okay. Yeah, that's good.
You didn't have to define away mental illness because it's called syndrome. And I think what you said would take care of that.
Yeah. I kind of questioned whether if it falls underneath mental illness or not. According to the research I read, it doesn't, but I think there are some relations there.
If you're not crazy, you're not normal.
Any other feedback? Any questions? Thanks for attending. We got to clean out the pizza. Again, we'll plan on next month. We'll be at Open Quest. We'll do the Friday evening. It sounds like that's the most more preferred. I wasn't sure about the weekends. That's kind of the most questionable thing about it. We'll do the Friday afternoon or evening. And as you go to talks, think about what you've learned and kind of want to share a little bit about it. And again, if you don't go to Open Quest, you can still come to the university.